That's how you change the world. 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 That's how you change the world.
It's my privilege to welcome you all, especially those of you who are watching us online. What a great joy that you can connect with us. Life online, we welcome you very much. Thank you so much for joining us this beautiful Sunday. And I'd like to take this opportunity to welcome all the Community Life Church members, but all those who are also watching us online from different parts of the world, from the US, from Europe, from Asia, from Africa, and different parts of Uganda. We welcome you today. Thank you so much for joining us. And again, we value this relationship. Please write to us, put a comment in the comment section. Let us know where you're watching from. We're sure would like to welcome you and acknowledge your presence. I want to take this time to thank all those of you who continue to partner with us as you give in your tithes and offerings. Those of you who have been very faithful in giving, we want to thank you very much, because it's through your generosity that we are able to extend the kingdom of God and continue to see souls coming to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, but also to help us. It helps us to be able to run the activities that we do here at Community Life Church. I want to thank you all who have given and continue to give towards land, property. We thank you very much, and we request that you continue to come alongside us, and let's partner together to invest for eternity. And the giving details will show up on your screen, or should be showing up on your screen. If you want to give by mobile money, or you want to give through direct bank transfers, they should be rolling on your screen right now, and you can use any of those opportunities to be able to give. Thank you very much. Now then, we are in our second week of Gratitude Determines Altitude, a great series that we're doing. And for us here at Community Life Church, the month of December, we just set that month aside to say thank you, God, for whatever you have done for us. And we don't just do this for the month of December, but we encourage that this becomes a lifestyle and a culture here at Community Life Church. And so last weekend, we were privileged that my wife was able to share on the subject, what and why gratitude. And today I am, privileged to join in and continue the series, Gratitude Determines Altitude. Simply said or explained, the distance or how high you will go in life, or how far you will go in life, is determined by how grateful you are in life. And God is looking for grateful people, and people are also happy to be around grateful people. And so today I join in. And today I'm going to be talking about, I've been reading a wonderful book, and I continue to read this book. It's a wonderful book called The Blessed Life. It's written by Pastor Robert Morris. and it's a great, great book. I started reading this book a couple of months ago, and I'm continuing, reading this book. And today I just want to talk about need, greed, and seed for Thanksgiving. Let me say that again. Need, greed, and seed for Thanksgiving. And basically, I'm going to be talking about giving thanks to God with our finances. The Bible says, where treasure, a man's treasure is, there his heart will also be. And we have figured that, the treasures of men, one of the treasures is finance. And if a man or woman can be able to release their finance, then you know that their trust or sufficiency is not in the finance, but their sufficiency is in the Almighty God. So we're going to be reading from 2 Corinthians chapter 9 and verse 6 through 8. But let me first give you the context of that portion of scripture. Basically, Paul is writing to the Christians at Corinth. And in his writing, he's reminding them. He said, look, he's saying, look, guys, you committed yourself to being able to give towards the helping the Christians in Jerusalem. They're going through a critical time right now. The economy has gone down and they've been hit hard by the economy. And you promised that you would be able to give. And so he comes in and he reminds them and he says, look, you promised that you'll be able to give. So I'm here to remind you. So we see that the idea of raising finances for the extension of God's kingdom has not just begun now, but it began way back in Bible time. And this is exactly what Paul is doing. And so Paul is reminding, these brothers and sisters, and he's saying, please fulfill the pledge that you made. And, you know, as he does this, he then begins to brag. He begins to brag about the church at Corinth, how generous they were and how they desired to give. And then also in there, he mentions the Macedonian church, and he mentions how they really were asking to give, even though they were a poor church. They didn't have much, but they were asking and begging and saying, can we be a part of this thing? And so as we talk about generosity, being a part of Thanksgiving, especially in the area of finance, I want you to know that generosity is not so much about having and how much you have, but generosity is basically, you know, the state of the heart. And when you look at this Macedonian church that desired to be a part of the giving towards the call that Paul had given, and they didn't have much, but they still wanted to be a part of this. So then let's dive into the scripture. What does Paul say in 2 Corinthians chapter 9 and verse 6 through 8? He says, remember this, whoever sows, he's now telling the church at Corinth. He says, remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each one of you should give what you have decided in your heart, not giving reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And then verse 8, and God is also able to bless you abundantly, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. And as it is written, they have freely scattered their gifts to the poor, their righteousness endures. And this is a very profound portion of scripture that basically talks about generosity in the area of finance. And we as Community Life Church this year, every year we come together at the end of the year, and we count our blessings and we say, God, you have done so much for us. You have done A, B, C, D, E, F, G. We have so many things that we need to be grateful for this year. We need to be grateful for the gift of life. While many have gone, they've been taken by the virus, corona, and many other diseases and accidents. But, oh God, you have given us life. We are grateful. While, you know, many are struggling financially, God, you have given to us financially. You have provided for us for every need that we have needed. You have provided for us. You have given to us above and beyond what we have needed. You have given, brought family alongside us. You have brought friends alongside us. You have given to us, and we are grateful. And for us here at Community Life Church, we are particularly grateful that God has provided for us a piece of land where now we can go and be able to build a sanctuary, our permanent home, out of rent. And now we are on permanent ground. What an amazing God this is. You know, so we take all these blessings and we count them one by one. And then we say, God, we are grateful. God, we are thankful because you have done this for us. And so in verse 6, as we go back and begin to study slowly by slowly, Paul says, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. That word sparingly means reservedly. He who sows, he who gives reservedly will also reap reservedly. He who puts in the ground reservedly, whatever you put in the ground reservedly, you will also reap reservedly. But he who puts in the ground generously will also reap generously. So to the measure that you put it in, it will be to the same measure that it will come back to you. It's the same measure and more that it will come back to you. And so Paul is explaining the basic law of giving. And he says, you sow sparingly, you reap sparingly. But those same words that Paul says are the same words that Jesus says in the book of Luke chapter 6 and verse 38. And he says, Jesus said, give and it shall be given to you. In a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, will be poured into your lap. The same words that Paul is saying are the same words that Jesus is saying, but in a different way. Paul is saying, he who sows sparingly will reap sparingly. He who sows generously will reap generously. And Jesus is saying, give and it shall be given unto you. He says, in a good measure, that's what? Either sparingly or generously. In a good measure, he says, pressed down, shaken together, and running over will be poured into your lap. And then he says, for with the same measure you use, it will be measured to you. That is, sparingly or generously. If it is sparingly, you will receive a sparing blessing. But if it's generously, you will receive a generous blessing. So this is what Paul is saying, and this is what Jesus is saying. And this shows us that God not only notices what we give, but he also monitors what we give, and then he rewards our generosity. I can tell you here at Community Life Church, the members here at Community Life Church know God has been so faithful to us. You know, before we bought our property, we had 41 million shillings and we were believing God for 230 million shillings. And we knew that there's no way we're going to be able to get this money. And I told my team, I said, look, what we're going to do is what we have is seed. And we have an opportunity to either sow this seed or to eat this seed. And I told them, guys, what we're going to do is we're going to get part of this money and we're going to sow it. I know that it's confusing that we're believing God for 230 million shillings and then we're taking away from what we have, the 41 million, and we're giving it away. It looks like we're losing, but we're not losing. And I told them, guys, this is what we're going to do. And we did exactly that. We identified a church that was also doing what we're doing. They were also believing God for a piece of land. And we said, we're going to use this opportunity to sow a seed into this ministry. And we got a few million shillings off the 41 million shillings, and we gave that money away. And we said, God, we're sowing this seed into this ministry. We don't know whether they have or they don't have, but for us, it's a principle, and we want to do it. And we did it. And the doors have opened for us. I'm telling you, God has been so, he has amazed us that up to today, we're still receiving financial gifts from different people, all right? And somebody calls in and says, I want to be a blessing. Somebody calls in and says, I don't want to miss this blessing. I want to be a part of this blessing. And it's amazing how God is doing his thing. So God does not only notice how much we're giving, does not only notice our generosity, but he monitors, and in the monitoring, he rewards our generosity. And we have seen so many amazing rewards come for us. Let me tell you, you can never outgive God. There's just something that happens when we begin to talk about finance and people think that church wants their money. But the people here at Community Life Church know that, you know, we don't talk about money because church wants your money, because church already has money. Church belongs to God. And God, the Bible says, He owns silver and gold is His. So God is not really looking for your money or my money. After all, it's not even my money, but it is His money. It's not your money, but it is His money. But He's providing a platform of opening up the window of the overflow of His blessing into your life. And so when we begin to give generously, the scripture says we will receive a generous blessing. And when we give sparingly, then the blessing that will come to us will also be sparingly. And I encourage all of us to continue to be generous. Now, generosity is not about how much you give, but rather it's about, you know, the sacrifice that you put in when you are giving. That is what makes you either a generous person or not a generous. It's a sacrifice. It's not about how much you're giving. If you remember the lady that put in, you know, that little coin, and Jesus said, that lady has given the most. Why did Jesus say that? That lady has been the most generous. Why did Jesus say that? Jesus said that because she gave everything that she had. And that was a sacrifice, and it made her feel the pinch. So generosity is not about the amount that you're giving, but rather about the amount you are sacrificing. Generosity is about the amount that you are sacrificing. So then in verse 7 it says, now when you read verse 7 there, basically God wants us to choose how much we are to give. Because that's what verse 7 says. He says, don't give reluctantly. He says, but you choose in your heart what you want to give. And then somewhere he says, for God loves a cheerful giver. So verse 7, basically, God wants us to choose how much we're going to give. And He wants us to find pleasure in the same, to happily give. For He says, I love a cheerful giver. So when we're coming to give, when we're coming with our finances and we're coming to say, God, I want to thank you. You know, there are three things basically. And that's basically governance or power, authority, sex, and then finances. And if a man can be liberated in those three areas, then there's freedom that has come into a man's life or a woman's life. And so we come to God to release our finances. And as we release our finances, knowing that this is a treasure, we're basically saying all our sufficiency is not in the finances, but all our sufficiency is in the Almighty God who owns everything in this world. So we give cheerfully. We're coming excited. And here at Community Life Church, we are always excited about giving. We celebrate giving at Community Life Church. And I want to thank God for this wonderful church because, you know, they've done an amazing job. They're giving, they give sacrificially, and I'm just so happy to pastor a church like this one. So we give cheerfully and happily. You know, one of the greatest things, or one of the things that we need to find greatest pleasure in, is to be able to give towards what is happening in the kingdom of God. And when we find pleasure in that, then we open up other avenues of blessings for us. Because there are many things that make us happy in this world. Some people, just traveling alone makes them excited. Some people, you know, playing music makes them excited. Some people, singing makes them excited. Some people like me, you know, dogs bring excitement. But I don't know what makes you excited, but whatever makes you excited, this is the same principle that God is saying in verse 7. God loves a cheerful giver, a happy giver. This should bring excitement to us when it's time for us to be able to bring our finances and give towards the extension of your kingdom, because this is eternal investment. It should give us pleasure to be able to be a part of what God is doing. I'm excited to give. I'm here at CLC. I'm excited to give about what is happening at CLC and how God is using the seed that we're putting in to change many's lives. And then verse 8, he gives us a wonderful promise. He gives a wonderful promise for all those that will give. And let me read it. It says, verse 8 says, and God will generously provide all you need, and you will have everything you need and plenty left over for you to share with others. That's verse 8. Basically, what it's saying is that when you give, God then will generously provide, because there's always a fear. When I give, I'm actually losing. When I give, I'm actually, you know, I'm not going to have enough. But let me tell you, that's not true. That's a lie. He's saying that when you give, God will generously provide for what you need. To me, a couple of months ago, when we went into this COVID season, and at their workplace, they reduced their pay by a certain percentage. And, you know, this couple came to me and said, Pastor, they've cut our pay. But this is what we feel. We feel like we want to continue tithing as though we have been receiving the same from the same amount of money. Even if we've been cut down, we want to tithe at the same level we were. And I said, really? And they said, yes. I said, that's a great decision that you've made as a couple, and you're going to see God amaze you. And I prayed, and I prayed, and I prayed and believed that this would come to pass. And sure enough, as time went by during the COVID season, after a few months, you know, they came back to me and said, Pastor, you know, God has just restored our pay. It's gone back up to the normal what it was. So from this month onwards, we're going to be receiving the same. A few weeks ago, they came back to me and said, and by the way, our bosses have said this month of December, we're going to be paid all the money that had been cut off, all right, in the months while we were in lockdown. Not only have we been restored, but all our money that had been cut off for the month of December, we're going to be given that money. That is amazing. And that's exactly what verse 8 is explaining. He says, verse 8 says, and God will generously provide for all your need. God is now generously providing for the needs that they have. But why? Because they place themselves at a point of giving to what's happening in God's kingdom. When you sow generously, God will also provide for you generously. He will give you so that you may have plenty and left over, so that you can be able to share with others, so that you can live in overflow. I want you to note this, that money is not our sufficiency. God is our sufficiency. There are people who have placed so much emphasis on money, and they're so tight, and they're so greedy, and they won't release. And they are so, you know, they want to keep it to themselves. And that's a miserable life, because the message there is that all our life, all our sufficiency is in finances. But that's not true. And you know, that is where we need to pass what I'm calling the need test. We have needs and God provides for us. And we've seen God provide. And when we say give, we first look at the needs that we have. And we say, if I give, then I'm not going to have enough. But the scripture has said, God will provide for all that you need so that you may have more than what you need. You may have plenty left over so that you can be able to share with others. So the plenty is basically so that you can be able to share with others. And we need to pass the need test. And basically the need test is every time we want a little bit more. But when we say give and we begin to look at our needs, then we're not passing our need test. But to pass the need test is, it says, you look at the needs that you have and you're being challenged to give and you say, I will give no matter what. You have passed the need test. This couple that I'm telling you, they passed the need test. They had so many needs. Their finances have been cut, but yet they're saying, you know what? We still want to give. We still want to tithe up there, as though we're receiving that same amount. And they passed the need test, and now God has brought back all sufficiency in their lives, and He has blessed them. This test is the test when we ask God, will I have enough when I give? Will I have enough? And we need to be able to pass that test. We need to be able to put our trust in God. The Bible says, those that trust in God, He will never be able to put them to shame. You will not receive any shame as long as your trust is in God. And when we come and we generously and happily give to what's happening in the kingdom of God, we will never be put to shame. God will provide for us. And you know, as God continues to provide, then we need to pass the greed test. The greed basically is keeping everything to ourselves. It's mine, it's mine, it's mine. It's mine. And we keep things to ourselves and we begin to accumulate things for ourselves. We need to pass that test. And once we pass that test, then we begin to sow seeds in the kingdom of God. We begin to sow seeds for the extension of the kingdom of God. We begin to sow seeds for eternity. And this December, we're sowing seeds for the extension of the kingdom of God, but we're also sowing seeds of thanksgiving. And we're coming to God with finances and we're saying, God, this is a tool, this is a power. This is a thing that has controlled many people in this world, but this thing shall not control us. You have given it to us the whole of this year. We want to give it back to you with a heart of gratitude to say thank you for what you have done for us. And this shall be used again to extend your kingdom. And so we sow into the kingdom of God, and then we see the work of the Lord continue to progress. I want to read for you the last portion of scripture from 2 Corinthians chapter 9 and verse 10. And it says, now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion. And through us, your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. So we have the needs, but we don't look at our needs. In the midst of our needs, we say we'll give, because we know that God will bring it back to us in a good measure. All right? And what I didn't tell you there, you know, when you plant corn seed, maize, you plant one seed, but when it grows and then it brings that corn, the cob, you know, it has so many seeds on there. And they say usually you'd have about, you know, a couple of seeds, depending on how big it is. But you can even go up to about 800 seeds on there. That is bringing back more than you needed when you sowed the seed. So we pass the need test. And when God begins to provide for us, we also pass the great test of saying, I won't keep this to myself, but I'll give. I'll turn it into a seed for thanksgiving. And when we do that, then the overflow comes into our lives. My friends, I'm going to tell you this. God wants us to live a life of overflow so that in everything that, you know, that we have, we continue to live that life of overflow so that we can be able to share with others. Now, on the 3rd of January, all of us here at Community Life Church, we're going to be giving a special Thanksgiving offering, and we're going to be generous in our giving. And this is basically going to, we're going to take some of this money and bless another church and bless, you know, take a percentage off and give it away. Again, we're sowing seed, all right, into what God is doing. We're going to do this. And then, you know, the other percentage is going to be able to help us to move into our, you know, our private property, the property that God has given to us as we develop it slowly by slowly. So I want to encourage you, wherever you are, to join in. Join in us. Join with us as we give a special gift of thanksgiving financially to thank God for this year, for sustaining us, for bringing, you know, giving us food, giving us jobs, giving us life, giving us friends, giving us family. Thank God. But also as a point of dedicating 2021 and saying, God, this is our seed. As we dedicate 2021, we pray that we shall live in overflow. Well, I hope that you've been blessed today. Let me just hand you over to Rebecca, and then I'll come back and pray for you. Don't you leave.
It's always a great blessing to have you join us for our celebration service, and we hope that you have enjoyed your stay. What are you grateful to God for? We know that this year has come with quite unusual seasons that may have affected everyone in one way or another, but God has remained faithful in so many ways. The Bible calls us to rejoice at all times and give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God for us through Christ Jesus. So as this year comes to an end, we are giving you an opportunity to extend your gratitude through thanksgiving.
Thank you so much for that, Rebecca. Before I pray, I want to remind you that on the 3rd of January, we're going to be giving a special Thanksgiving offering, and I want you to join in. Give generously, all right? Give generously, because we're using this to extend God's kingdom. Right now on your screen, you should be having numbers, mobile money numbers that are passing by, showing on your screen. You can use those numbers. You can use the bank transfer number. If you're ever around near the church premises, you can come pick an envelope. The Thanksgiving envelope is a brown envelope. And pray about what God is going to challenging you to give. And on the 3rd of January, we'll all give together. Let me pray for you today. Father, thank you so much for every man and woman that is out there. Today, we have looked at Thanksgiving, but giving thanks with our finances. So, Father, I pray that God, you will help us to be loosed, Lord, from greed or from this need thing that will pass the test. And we'll be generous people, especially things pertaining to extension, the extension of your kingdom. That we'll extend your kingdom enough with the finances that you've given to us, knowing that we're only stewards. So I pray that God will be able to do this as we invest in your kingdom and in eternity, that we'll see great results coming back to us. So bless your people today. I pray for a special week. Grant them a great week, a week of victory, that the testimonies that you're bringing here at Community Life Church will be the same testimonies that you're giving to all these men and women. So bless them, I pray. The Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you. The Lord lift up his countenance on you. The Lord be gracious to you. And the peace of God, the personal understanding, guard your hearts now and forevermore. Amen. Well, thank you so much for joining us today. And until next time, God bless you. Be sure to invite your friend again to tune in next weekend. And God bless you. Have yourselves a victorious week.
There is a song I know. My soul.